Good morning and welcome to Main Street Presbyterian Church. I especially want to welcome you if you're visiting with us today. There are cards on the back of the pews with information for visitors. If you are wanting to learn more about Main Street Presbyterian Church, then please fill one of those cards out and we would love to get back in contact with you and answer any questions that you might have. Before we begin our worship service, if you'll turn to the back page in your bulletin where the announcements are, I want to remind you of a few things going on this week. We would love for you to join us this evening at 6 o'clock for our evening worship service. We are working our way through the first five chapters of the book of Deuteronomy. Our women at church are having their evening Bible study this Tuesday at 7 p.m. at the home of Lori Flora. If you're not attending that meeting, but you are interested in it, please call the church office. The phone number is on the back page of the bulletin, and you can find out more and get directions for Lori's home. Wednesday night, we have our Wednesday night activities. Meal starts at 5:30. Deli sandwiches will be provided. If you can bring a side or a dessert, that would help. Our Bible study will start at 6, and we are doing a study this semester in our Wednesday nights titled Walking with God in Our Suffering. If anyone has children interested in participating in our communicants class, please let the church know. We have five children that we know of right now. If you're unfamiliar with what communicants class is, this is a class for children who are of an age where they understand the Christian faith and want to make a public profession of that faith before the congregation and begin participating in the sacrament of the Lord's Supper. So if you have a child that is in that position, please call the church office, and we will get back with you soon with information about when that class will start. February is Missions Month, and our missions conference starts next weekend. If you look on the back page, the activities for the week, the first session of our missions conference is on Saturday at 3:30, and that lasts till 6, and then there is a catfish fry afterwards. So I would encourage as many of you as are able to come to that. The second session of the missions conference is during our morning worship service, and then the third session is during our evening worship service next Sunday. There's no deacons meeting this week. I know that there was an email that was circulated to the deacons. That's been canceled, and you'll get an email from Bill with a new date for that. And also, I want you to be in prayer for one of our shut-ins, Miss Dot Norton. I received a call from her son yesterday, Ed Norton. She is in very serious condition right now, and he indicated that she may not make it through this week. She's a member of this church, a woman in her mid-90s, and just pray that the Lord would be with her and with her family at this time. Those are all the announcements I have. If you'll just take a few moments to prepare your hearts and your minds for the worship of our God. Often in the book of Psalms, you have statements that were used to read to the Jews as they approached God in temple worship, and they were to encourage the people of God to worship in his presence. And one of those statements is found in Psalm 149, verses 1 to 4. The psalmist encourages the congregation of the children of God with these words. He says, "Praise the Lord. Sing to the Lord a new song, his praise in the assembly of the godly. Let Israel be glad in his maker. Let the children of Zion rejoice in their king. Let them praise his name with dancing, making melody to him with the tambourine and the lyre. For the Lord takes pleasure in his people. He adorns the humble with salvation." We're going to begin our worship service with a hymn of praise to our God. If you'll turn to hymn number 92, we're going to sing a hymn authored by Martin Luther. "A mighty fortress is our God." If you'll please stand. God and Father, we stand in your presence this day in awe and wonder as we consider what a God you are. You are the creator of the heavens and the earth, and you created in such a marvelous way. You spoke and things came into existence. We thank you for how you created the human race. You created the human race in the image of the triune God. What a privilege it is, and what dignity all human beings have based on that fact. To disturb another human is to give offense to the Creator. Oh Lord our God, we humble ourselves in your presence, for we know that we don't deserve to have access to you. We know that we are corrupt, we are sinful, and we know, oh Lord, that the only reason we stand here with boldness and confidence in your presence, knowing that you love us and you delight in us, is because of what your Son has done. He has completed perfectly all of the requirements of your holy law for us. He's paid all of the debt we owe for our sin on the cross and by the shedding of his blood. He has empowered us through his resurrection so that we too might walk in newness of life. We are recreated in the image of Christ, and we rejoice in this truth. Oh Lord God, we come as those who we know that we are to act like Christ. We know that the Spirit of God is in us, and yet we find ourselves struggling to press on. We find ourselves reverting back to the old man, as it's put in the Scripture, doing things that are earthly instead of things that are heavenly. And we plead with you, be merciful to us. We plead with you, be patient with us. And we beg of you to pour out more of the graces of Christ upon this people gathered here today, so that we might live in such a way that brings honor and glory and praise to your name. And we pray especially, Lord God, that you would make us a humble people, a people who are in touch with the grace that we have received, so that we can show grace to others, with the love that you have demonstrated to us, so that we can show love to others. Receive our worship this day. Bless us with your grace. Amen. We're going to read a section of God's law from the Old Testament book of Leviticus, chapter 19. We're going to read the first four verses and then skip to verse 11 to 18. And this section of Scripture is relevant because I'll be preaching on the last several verses of Matthew 5, and Jesus makes reference to a statement made in this section of Leviticus. What does God expect of his people? Leviticus 19 says, "And the Lord spoke to Moses, saying, speak to all the congregation of the people of Israel, and say to them, you shall be holy, for I, the Lord your God, am holy. Every one of you shall revere his mother and his father, and you shall keep my Sabbaths. I am the Lord your God. Do not turn to idols or make for yourself any gods of cast metal. I am the Lord your God. When you offer a sacrifice of peace offering to the Lord, you shall offer it so that you may be accepted." If you'll turn to verse 11. "You shall not steal. You shall not deal falsely. You shall not lie to one another. You shall not swear by my name falsely, and so profane the name of your God. I am the Lord. You shall not oppress your neighbor or rob him. The wages of a hired servant shall not remain with you all night until the morning. You shall not curse the deaf or put a stumbling block before the blind, but you shall fear your God. I am the Lord. You shall do no injustice in court. You shall not be partial to the poor or defer to the great, but in righteousness shall you judge your neighbor. You shall not go around as a slanderer among your people, and you shall not stand up against the life of your neighbor. I am the Lord. You shall not hate your brother in your heart, but you shall reason frankly with your neighbor, lest you incur sin because of him. You shall not take vengeance or bear a grudge against the sons of your own people. But you shall love your neighbor as yourself. I am the Lord." If you look in your bulletin, on the first page, we have a public confession of sin. We're going to join together in reading that. And it's based on this theme of loving our neighbor. So let us join together in confessing our sin. O Holy Father, we know your will is the way of love, for you so love the world that you sent your only begotten Son. We are created and redeemed to love you and all men. Your law is the law of love. Sadly, we have been satisfied with lesser love than we ought. Often we have ignored you. Often we have loved only our friends when our enemies need us. Forgive us for not greeting one another in love, for withholding the kind deed, for letting loose the word of anger, for harboring resentments, and for plotting revenge. Forgive us and make us ready to forgive. Through Jesus our Savior. Amen. I want you to hear these words of assurance. I do want you to think about what we said. There's always this tendency to aimlessly read through one of these prayers, and that's not our intention. This is a very serious matter of addressing sin in the hearts of all of us. How many of us, when somebody has slighted us or offended us, do we find it easy to withhold a kind deed? We may not be doing something to hurt them, but we will make sure we're not doing anything to care for them, to love them, or to serve them. I think this particular sin really exposes our own hearts, and therefore it's appropriate for us to confess our sin. But we do that not to bash you down, but to help you to see the glories of the salvation that Christ has won for you. You have been saved from your sins. The Father embraces you with love because of the Son. He doesn't hold those things against you. And I think you have to understand this grace in your life for you to worship God. Who can worship God from the heart, singing praise and glory and joy to someone, to a being who they think hates them? You can't do it. You can only worship rightly if you know the liberation that the gospel gives you. So what does the psalmist say? What does David say in Psalm 130, verses 3 and 4, about the nature of his God? The author of the psalm is wrestling with his own sinfulness, and he writes this to the Lord. He says to the Lord, "If you, O Lord, should mark iniquities, if you should keep track of all of my specific faults, if you, O Lord, should mark iniquities, O Lord, who could stand?" You couldn't stand here and worship if that's how God treated you. The psalmist goes on, "But with you there is forgiveness, that you may be feared." And that term, "that you may be feared," is, it essentially means that you may be worshiped. "I wait for the Lord, my soul waits, and in his word I hope. My soul waits for the Lord more than the watchman for the morning, more than the watchman for the morning. O Israel, hope in the Lord, for with the Lord there is steadfast love. With him is plentiful redemption, and he will redeem Israel from their iniquities." And that's what I want to declare to all of you who are resting in Christ this morning. Your sins have been wiped from the record of God's presence. He remembers them no more. He accepts you as pure, righteous, and undefiled in his sight, and he embraces you with open arms. Now worship him. Worship him. In response, we're going to sing two hymns of praise. They're both printed in the bulletin, and they're both about this doctrine of God's forgiveness. There is a Redeemer, and then it'll be followed. You'll pick up on the change in music with Lamb of God, and I would ask that you please stand as we sing.
There is a Redeemer, Jesus God's own Son. Thank you, Father, for giving us your your only son. Side to be led by your staff and rod, and to be called a lamb of God. Oh, Lamb of God, sweet Lamb of God, oh, Lamb of God, who washed me in His precious blood, Jesus Christ.
Please bow your heads and join with me as we go before the Lord in prayer. Dear Lord God, as we come before you this morning, we are mindful of the majestic and awesome God you are. What a privilege and blessing it is to come before you with our prayers and know that you do hear and answer them. We are aware of our corrupt and sinful nature. It grieves us as we think about how you would have us live and how often we see ourselves doing the very opposite things from what we know. How easy it is to feel discouraged and defeated. Lord, we pray that we would remember that as your people, we have been raised with Christ. We are your chosen ones, holy and beloved. Christ did it all. We are complete in him and can rejoice with unspeakable joy and full of glory. You have told us if anyone is in Christ, he is a new creation. The old has passed away. Behold, the new has come. May these your promises be the all-consuming reality that motivates all of our lives. We pray this morning for our upcoming missions conference next weekend. We pray for the members of the missions committee as they work diligently to plan and make preparations for this very special time we will have to learn more about the ministries and work of our missionaries. Create within us an excitement and anticipation to come and see how you are at work around the world. Be with Doug Hudson as he prays and prepares to be the keynote speaker in the services. Give him a special blessing of your wisdom and discernment as he seeks the message you would have him to bring. We also pray for Wiley Smith and Jim Keel as they prepare to come to share with us the work you are doing through them. May we be committed to praying for them and supporting them throughout the whole year and not just at this time of the conference. Lord, we lift up to you those who are sick and hurting within our congregation. It seems that so many are facing serious difficulties with their health. We confess that so often we do not understand, and there are so many questions without answers. Like Paul, we plead that the pains and difficulties would leave us. Let us hear the words you gave him. My grace is sufficient for you, for my power is made perfect in weakness. May we be like Paul and boast all the more gladly of our weakness so that the power of Christ may rest upon us. We lift up to you the Shaw family as they mourn the loss of Mr. Billy. We thank you for him and the way he lived his life in service to you. May they find comfort and joy in knowing that he is with you. For the sake of Christ, we are content with weakness, insults, hardships, persecutions, and calamities. For when we are weak, then we are strong. We pray for your continued work in us, your church here at Main Street. How faithful you have been in providing strong biblical preaching from this pulpit. What a blessing Todd has been in faithfully serving you with his preaching and shepherding the flock. Continue to be close to him. Keep him strong and use him in a mighty way to carry out your work. What a great God you are. To know that there is nothing too small or great in our lives to be outside your sovereign control. Give us faith to hold fast to the promise from your word and walk boldly as your people, children of the King. In Christ's name we pray. Amen.
If you'll please turn to Matthew chapter 5. We're going to conclude chapter 5 today, and the sermon will focus on verses 38 to 48. I'm going to read into chapter 6 as well, just to give you a little preview of what will be coming in a couple of weeks' time. Remember, we have a guest preacher for the morning and evening service next Sunday. And that is part of our missions conference. Hear what our Lord and Savior says about love. You have heard that it was said, an eye for an eye and a tooth for a tooth. But I say to you, do not resist the one who is evil. But if anyone slaps you on the right cheek, turn to him the other also. And if anyone would sue you and take your tunic, let him have your cloak as well. And if anyone forces you to go 1 mile, go with him 2 miles. Give to the one who begs from you, and do not refuse the one who would borrow from you. You have heard that it was said, You shall love your neighbor and hate your enemy. But I say to you, love your enemies and pray for those who persecute you, so that you may be sons of your Father who is in heaven. For he makes his sun rise on the evil and on the good, and sends rain on the just and on the unjust. For if you love those who love you, what reward do you have? Do not even the tax collectors do the same? And if you greet only your brothers, what more are you doing than others? Do not even the Gentiles do the same? You therefore must be perfect as your heavenly Father is perfect. Beware of practicing your righteousness before other people in order to be seen by them. For then you will have no reward from your Father who is in heaven. Thus, when you give to the needy, sound no trumpet before you, as the hypocrites do in the synagogues and in the streets, that they may be praised by others. Truly, I say to you, they have received their reward. But when you give to the needy, do not let your left hand know what your right hand is doing, so that your giving may be in secret, and your Father who sees in secret will reward you. And when you pray, you must not be like the hypocrites, for they love to stand and pray in the synagogues and at the street corners, that they may be seen by others. Truly I say to you, they have received their reward. But when you pray, go into your room and shut the door and pray to your Father who is in secret. And your Father who sees in secret will reward you. And when you pray, do not heap up empty phrases as the Gentiles do, for they think that they will be heard for their many words. Do not be like them, for your Father knows what you need before you ask him. Pray then like this: Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts, as we also have forgiven our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For if you forgive others their trespasses, your heavenly Father will also forgive you. But if you do not forgive others their trespasses, neither will your heavenly Father forgive your trespasses. The grass withers and the flowers fade, but the word of the Lord endures forever. The Jews in Jesus' time prided themselves on their knowledge and obedience to the law of God. Yet Jesus powerfully reveals in this fifth chapter of Matthew that the spirit in which they kept the law of God so meticulously, as they were convinced they were doing, was cruel, prideful, and foreign to God's intended purpose. A number of the children came up a couple of weeks ago because they had recited the questions, all of the questions in the children's catechism. And children, those of you that have gone through the children's catechism, you probably still remember question 76. It's right before the long teaching on the law. And in question 76 of the children's catechism, we hear this, or we read this: What is the sum of the Ten Commandments? What is the summary, the overview, the general purpose of God in giving the Ten Commandments? Children, any of you remember that from your catechism? You probably wouldn't want to recite it in front of everyone anyway. But it's simply this: to love God with all my heart and my neighbor as myself. Now, that's the goal, the purpose, the plan of God with giving the Ten Commandments: to incite an overwhelming love for God and love for our neighbors, regardless of whether they're members of Main Street Presbyterian Church or some other church or some synagogue or some whatever, non-Christians. The Ten Commandments incite love, if they're understood correctly. The law is meant to give stability to a society or a community. That's why churches function best when the congregants are committed to loving one another. And you've probably all, or some of you have experienced churches where there's not a lot of love. There's sections and groups of people who despise other groups and sections in the church. Those are miserable places for everyone involved. And they will ultimately lead to some type of a division or break. The Jews used the law in such a way as to sanction, legitimize cruelty and hurtful practices towards one another. Now, let me explain. We read a section on anger in verses 21 to 26. How does that lead to cruel behavior? Well, the way the Jews interpreted was this. If you haven't acted out on your anger, if you haven't committed murder, then you're good with God. You have fulfilled His law. Even though they harbored deep bitterness and resentment towards other people in their hearts, they used a false interpretation of the law to legitimize hatred towards people as long as they didn't act out on it by stabbing them or poisoning them or whatever way murder might be committed. You're good if you don't commit adultery with another man's wife. You're loving him. You're good. But it's okay in your mind to examine your brother's wife, to look her up and down, and to have sexual fantasies about her. Do you see the cruelty in their practice of the law? It's okay to break oaths, to change your word, as long as you haven't sworn in the name of the Lord. And then we come to our section, which is probably the most blatant revelation by Christ or exposure by Christ of the insanity of the Jewish interpretation and practice of law-keeping. We see described in these verses perfect love, a love that originates in divine places and is demanded upon humans. First thing I want us to look at as we examine this passage is the two qualities of love that are revealed here. And we're going to spend most of our time looking at these two qualities. We'll follow that up by looking at an example of love that's found in this text, and then the way by which or in which we participate in this love. Two qualities of love. In verses 38 to 42, we learn that love does not demand its rights. And that's important to hear because we live in a day and age where we want to fight for our rights. Everything's about protecting your rights and your privileges. And Jesus cuts counter to that. He's countercultural in his teaching. You have this statement, you have heard that it was said, an eye for an eye and a tooth for a tooth. And that is a passage found in the Old Testament law. You can find it in Leviticus 24, 20 and following. And you also find it in Deuteronomy 21. But you need to understand how they're manipulating this teaching. In the Old Testament, eye for an eye, tooth for a tooth had a purpose in their judicial system. Remember, in Old Testament law, they weren't just legislating for a church. It wasn't just like ecclesiastical law about how a church should live. It was national law. There was a judicial element to what was going on. So the purpose of eye for eye, tooth for tooth was to prevent the abuse in the justice system of measuring out punishment that exceeded a crime that was committed. So if someone is in a fight with you and they somehow injure your eye so that you can't see out of it, it is illegitimate in the Jewish legal system to punish that person by death. Eye for eye, not eye for death. That was the basis and the purpose of this law. But what did the Jews do in Jesus' time? What was the practical outworking of this teaching in their everyday relationships? And I want to make a clear distinction. Jesus is not prohibiting the use of the judicial system. He's not saying, if you have a child that is brutally murdered, that you should just forgive the person and look the other way. And if you look through the whole of the New Testament, there's ample proof that that's the case, because Paul continues to uphold the judicial element of human government. He says the government bears the sword so that they can punish crime. So that's not what he's dealing with. That is not the teaching of Christ to the Christian community, a form of pacifism where you do nothing in light of criminal cases. He's talking about the personal level. And I want you to make that distinction in your mind. The Jews used this law as an excuse for demanding their rights in common day-to-day relationships. If you offend me by some comment you make at a social gathering or in the office or in the church, this law says I can offend you back at some point. Do you see their mindset? They legitimized bitterness, unlawful anger, and revenge based on the law. They thought by doing those things, they're keeping the law. They're pleasing God. And they were fueling their own arrogance. If you slap me, this law allows me to slap you back. Now, slapping in their culture, it wasn't so much a violent offense as it was a slight on your person. It was kind of like spitting in someone's face. It was derogatory to get slapped in the face. And we still see that today. If someone slaps you in the face, it's probably not going to do any physical damage to you, most likely. But it's a statement about what a person thinks of you. If you insult me, then I'm going to insult you back. This spirit of retribution in day-to-day relationships reveals a spirit of malice, bitterness, and jealousy. All of the things that the New Testament consistently preaches against. Now let me ask you, as we think of this quality, love doesn't demand its rights. How do you treat people here in this church who you feel, rightly or wrongly, have offended you in some way? Maybe you've passed someone in the hallway and said hello, and they just keep on walking. And you're offended. Do you return the favor? What goes on in your heart when that happens to you? When somebody really makes you feel as if they don't care about you? Do you develop some type of bitterness? I do. I think most of us would acknowledge that we do too. How do you treat people in the office? You're to be salt and light. So how does Jesus' teaching in Matthew 5 work its way out in the workplace for you? When you're rubbing shoulders with people who may not be pulling their weight or doing the things that you want them to do. How do you treat your spouse? your children, your extended family, when they offend you, what do you do? Children, how do you treat your parents? When they ask you to do things that maybe you don't really want to do. This is very practical teaching. This is stuff that we can relate to. This is stuff that hits home in our heart. Do you get yours back when somebody has hurt, has inflicted some type of a wound, emotional or whatever, on you? Jesus says, this is wrong. He says, we're not to demand our rights. That's not the love of the Father. Then he gives us a second quality. Love doesn't discriminate. Verses 43 down to 48. Now, this is a blatant misuse of the law. We read in Leviticus that it never teaches the things that are mentioned here. You have heard that it was said, you shall love your neighbor and hate your enemy. It never says that in the Old Testament. It says, love your enemy. Or it says, love your neighbor. It never says, hate your enemy. Jesus goes on to say, but I say to you, love your enemies and pray for those who persecute you, so that you may be sons of your Father who is in heaven. This is where it really gets hard. Maybe we don't return evil for evil. All right, we've grown in our maturity enough not to do that. Although I would argue that if you think you're above that, you need to search your soul a little deeper. Love does not discriminate. The Jews practiced a form of discriminatory love. This was a problem that they found hard to shake even when they accepted Christ and became members of the Christian community. And let me give you a few instances of that that are recorded for us in the book of Acts. The hardline Jews, guys like Paul, who became Christians, they were committed to the Hebrew language and dialect. They didn't want to speak the Greek. Hey, that's culturally wrong for us to do. We don't want to cave culturally to anything. We're not even going to speak the Greek language because we might embrace some of their Greek philosophical mindset. We're Hebrews of Hebrews. We speak the language. We memorize the scripture. We have our little holy huddles where we avoid contact with the Gentiles but the Jews who had embraced Greek culture. There were distinctions among the Jewish people, the Hebrews and the Hellenistic Jews. And you know what happens? They don't even like each other. They're both Jews, but they despise each other because of their different cultures. And it works itself out in the church community because the Hebrews, when they were receiving money and gifts from the church to help with their widows, they didn't give any to the Hellenistic Jews. Within their own communities, these divisions and lack of love existed. Then, when the Gentiles started coming into the church, they really had a problem with that. Man, can't we just have different churches, like Jew churches and Gentile churches? Paul says, No, you're going to have to figure it out and get along and love people who are outside of your social spectrum. That's hard. But nonetheless, it's required. Perfect love, the love of the Father, is blind to religion. We're Reformed Presbyterians. But how do we talk about Baptists and Methodists and Pentecostals? Sad to say, sometimes not in the way that is prescribed here. We think we're better, theologically superior. If your Heavenly Father can love people who don't even believe in Him, who ridicule Him, can't you love other denominations of the Christian church? You better. And you better watch what you say about them, because you might be worshiping with them in glory. I love George Whitefield. Hard-nosed, reformed, believed in the sovereignty of God, had a major issue with the founder of the Methodist Church, John Wesley. And you know what Whitefield said? And this is the spirit we need to be embracing, because it's the spirit of Christ. He said, even though he doesn't agree with me on the role of God in salvation, he's going to be far in front of me when we're worshiping God in heaven. He's going to be much closer to the throne than I am. That's what Jesus is teaching us. That's the kind of radical love that shatters our prejudices, that breaks down the walls of discrimination. Perfect love is blind to religion, race, lifestyle. Do you owe anything to the LGBT community? Yes, you owe them love. Do you have to agree with them and support them? Absolutely not. And I think the best picture of this is Chick-fil-A. Chick-fil-A is a Christian organization. They're not the church. They've made clear statements about their stand on marriage issues. One man, one woman, that's the Bible's teaching. We're clear. But when there was that massacre that occurred in Orlando, you know what they did? They opened their store on Sunday, which they didn't commonly do, so that they could serve those people with food. That they never said, we are on board with your practices. We believe in homosexuality. No, they were clear in their stance against it, but it didn't keep them from loving their neighbor. We live in a society that is so politically charged that we think wrongly about people of different political parties. Jesus would say you can't do that. You may differ with your political ideals, but they are image bearers of my Father, and you must love them regardless. This is an active love, an attempt to do good to all that God puts in our way. You think of the story of the Good Samaritan. Jesus uses this to illustrate. The Samaritan. All of the Jews pass by this man who's been injured, beaten up. The Samaritan evidences the type of love that Jesus is talking about here. We've got to get out of our mind that loving someone who disagrees with us is a form of compromise. How ridiculous is that? Can we not love someone and still hold to our beliefs very strongly and firmly? Absolutely. And that's what Jesus is saying. If your father does it, how much more so should you? Listen to what he says. I say to you, love your enemies. Pray for those who persecute you, so that you may be sons of your Father who is in heaven. For listen to what he does. He makes his sun rise on the evil and on the good. On the evil and the good. He sends rain on the just and the unjust. For if you love those who love you, what reward do you have? That's easy. Love your enemy. We have here an example of love, and this will be very brief. I think it's clear enough. Jesus sets the example of God the Father before his audience. The Father actively does good to all, even his enemies. Verse 48 describes this as the standard of perfect love. This teaching that we're dealing with here is a doctrine called common grace. And it's a term, common grace is a term used in theology for the demonstration of divine acts of kindness on undeserved human beings regardless of their eternal destiny. Okay? So God doesn't say, this is going to be someone with me in heaven, so I'm going to let the rain fall on them and let the sun shine on them. No, this is a person who despises me, rebels against me, and I'm still going to let my sun shine and my rain fall on this person too. It's grace that is common to all. That's the love that he's talking about. God doesn't allow offenses to his name or his grace or his character keep him from doing good. And this is most prominently displayed in Jesus Christ, who the Father sent for his enemies, people who were hostile to him, so that he could die on a cross to give them life. Now, how do we participate in this divine love? Our third and final and brief point. First of all, when we understand what Jesus is talking about, it's humbling. And I hope there's not a single one of you who thinks you are loving appropriately. If anything, I hope that this is driving you in desperation to fall at the feet of God and say, teach me to love. Teach me to love like this. I find it easy to love people that are share the same personality traits as me, are in the same socioeconomic bracket as me, like the same football team as me, whatever the case is. But how do I mature in my Christian faith to a degree where I can genuinely say, I wish no ill upon person X, family Y, group D, whatever. Teach me to develop in that way. Well, let me ask you this. What's happening when we're saved? We're told in Scripture that in salvation, God is doing a work in us, a creative act in us. We are united to Christ. Our identity is wrapped up in him. We are born again by the Spirit of God. We receive forgiveness of sins through his crucifixion. We are purified. Our slate is cleansed. But we also receive the power of a new life through his resurrection. Created new in Christ Jesus. It is a mark of divine grace in your life. It is a mark of salvation that you evidence to some degree a love similar to the Father's love. In this world, you're not perfect in it, but you will begin to evidence it if you are genuinely saved. You're not going to be perfect, but you will desire that perfection of your love. Now, turn with me in 1 John. Chapter 4, one of the best passages dealing with love. John, or 1 John 4, verse 7 says this, Beloved, and I want you to listen to the word of God. Listen to the word of God on this subject. Beloved, let us love one another, for love is from God. And whoever loves has been born of God and knows God. Anyone who does not love does not know God, because God is love. Now, like I said, there are degrees in which we know it, but if you find in your heart as you examine it that you are a bitter person, that you harbor resentment and anger, and you're not dealing with that, that's a problem. We're not perfect at it, but it is something we are progressing in throughout our lives. Paul speaks to the church in Colossae and to the Thessalonians, he gives thanks to the Father for their faith, their love, and their hope. He says, I see love in you. Now, love more and more. It's not perfect, but I see it in you, and I don't give you thanks for that because it's not coming from you. I give the Father thanks because he's working it in and through you as a work of his salvation. The early church made a practice of loving its enemies. Paul called the church to pray for the government at that time, and it was the same government that was persecuting, severely persecuting Christians. And we as Americans struggle to pray for a government that is far, far better, whether it's on the right or the left, the middle, whatever form of government it is, we struggle to pray. Consider a modern example. We'll conclude with this. Civil rights leaders, Martin Luther King Jr. and Malcolm X. What was the difference between those men? Martin Luther King Jr. was committed to a principle of loving his enemies like you find here in Matthew 5. Salt and light, effective in getting what he was after. Malcolm X, also a civil rights leader, coming from an Islamic background, promoted violent hostility. The Jews, they wanted Christ to come, take his sword out, and go to battle with the Romans. Jesus came, sheathed his sword, mounted a cross, and gave his life. This is love, perfect love. If you lack it, it's in Christ. Seek him, plead with him to mold and shape you in the image of his perfect Father. Amen. Oh Lord, we come and we confess that your standard, we thought it was high as we looked at the teaching on anger and adultery and oath-taking, but now we come to this passage on love, and it exceeds any of our imagination, anything we could imagine in terms of how we are to live. Lord, we're not perfect, but teach us the love of the Father. Help us to be like him, especially, Lord. It's easy to love our friends and family. Teach us to love our enemies, Lord. Mature us in Christ-likeness, we pray. Amen.
How deep the Father's love for us, how vast beyond all measure, that he should give his only son to make a wretch his treasure. How great the pain of searing loss, the Father turns his face away. In anything, no gifts, no power, no wisdom, but I will boast in Jesus Christ, his death and resurrection. Why should I gain from this reward? I cannot give an answer.
Let us depart now with the blessing of the triune God. The grace of the Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God the Father, the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with you all. Amen.